Started my day earlier on Capitol Hill in a conversation with Senator Rob Portman, of course, Republican from Ohio, who was one of the key architects of the infrastructure bill that the president signed into law earlier this week. We talked about the next stage here, among other issues, the reconciliation plan that, as Emily mentioned, could get a vote as soon as tonight, a plan that Republicans say will cause inflation to grow even worse, and one that Democrats say will, in fact, lower prices on everything from drugs to housing to other issues. And that's where I started asking Senator Portman if the White House and Democrats were wrong.
They're wrong about the lowering costs. In fact, it'll increase costs for everything because it'll add to the inflationary pressure we already have in our economy. If you look at what happened in March when the $1.9 trillion bill was passed, it added more demand to the marketplace, more stimulus spending, which put a lot of pressure on inflation. By the way, that was predicted by a lot of people, including a lot of smart economists on both sides of the aisle, Larry Summers being one, former Democratic Treasury Secretary for President Obama. A lot of us raised that concern, and we're seeing it again. So with the high level of stimulus spending in this second bill, this is the so-called Build Back Better legislation, yes, or also called the Reckless Tax and Spend Bill, also called the Reconciliation Bill. There won't be a single Republican supporting it. It'll be a partisan bill that's jammed through the process. And it's going to add to the inflationary pressure we already have. So it's kind of scary. We had 0.9% inflation increase last month. If you annualize that, that's 11.4% or so. Double-digit inflation is what we're looking at right now. We haven't had that for 40 years. So it's a serious concern. Second, of course, it has big tax increases that'll hurt our economy right now. And then finally, of course, it has significant spending that's not offset. We don't know how much yet. It's somewhere between, I think, $270 billion and $3.5 trillion, depending on how you look at it. But that's just adding to our debt and deficit in ways that does not add to economic growth and therefore, more revenue coming in through growth, which all of this is in contrast to the infrastructure bill, which is long-term spending. Much of it won't be spent for the next 3 or 4 or 10 years even. And that goes into hard capital assets, adding to the supply side of the economy, which should be counterinflationary.
I know you've been involved in this debate, like I said, since the outset. So you've had a good sense of what the president's priorities are. When you hear about specific issues like universal pre-K, expanded child care, for instance, the CBO says they came in under cost. The price tag seems to match what lawmakers were looking for here. Do you support any of those as individual investments?
Well, I mean, we don't know what they are, first of all, so we have to see the details. But look, we have a situation now where our debt is approaching $30 trillion, unprecedented, not just in terms of the nominal amount, which, of course, is the most ever, but as a percent of our economy. We have raging inflation. If you ask folks what their number one concern is back in Ohio, they'll tell you it's the price of gas. I filled up my pickup last week, and it was $100. People just are blown away by the inflation numbers, cost of groceries and so on. So that's what we ought to be focusing on right now. And to add new social programs at this time, to me, is a mistake. By the way, we just did it again in March, $1.9 trillion of spending. Mm-hmm. Put that into context, we have about a $4 trillion budget. We've spent more in this first 7-8 months of the Biden administration than we normally spend in an entire year's budget. So
will this bill be dismantled in the Senate after the House sends it over, assuming that passes the House?
We'll see. It's a 50-50 Senate, and it's very ambitious to get something like this through a 50-50 Senate. It's equally divided. Not a single Republican will support it. Because of the tax increases, because of the high spending, because of its impact on inflation. Yeah. So, it's not up to me. It's going to be up to Democrats like Joe Manchin and Kyrsten Sinema. They're both, fiercely independent senators, and they want to do what's right for their constituents in the country. So sure. We'll see how it ends up.
I'd like to ask you about the debt ceiling that's creeping up on us once again. Will you vote with Democrats to lift or suspend the debt ceiling to avoid a U.S. default?
Well, we cannot default, and Democrats control the White House and the House and effectively the Senate, because although it's a 50-50 Senate, because of a tie vote by the Vice President, they have control of the Senate, so they have the ability to do it on their own.
And they should?
They should, and they know that. And again, if you add the $1.9 trillion, which no Republicans supported, to the next bill, which may be somewhere between $2 and $6 trillion, depending on how you look at it, that's the main reason you need to raise the debt ceiling. So they need to make space for that, and I would think they'd be happy to do that.
Does it bother you that the debt ceiling has become a partisan issue? This is something that you've gone through many times in your career.
Well, it's always a partisan issue, and it's a tough one. And I was, you know, one of the 11 Republicans who voted to stop debate and allow a vote on it several weeks ago, because we cannot default and we shouldn't default. Everybody knows that. But, you know, I think it's important that Democrats take responsibility here. You know, they have the ability to do it. They are in control, and it's to make room for their spending that we need to raise the debt limit as high as we do. So I think that's the better way forward.
We're on watch for an announcement on the Fed, Senator. As you well know, the president is expected the next couple of days to announce his nomination, at least for Fed chair. It appears to be either Jay Powell or Lael Brainard. Would you vote to confirm either of them?
Well, I'm a Jay Powell supporter. I am concerned about what the Fed has done in terms of particularly its balance sheet, you know, expanding its balance sheet at a time of this high inflation. So I think of the two of them, Jay Powell is better equipped to be able to deal with that issue. I also think he has more trust and respect among the markets, which is going to be important as we get into these tough times where we're looking at inflation, looking at what to do on interest rates and so on. So My hope is that the president will nominate Jay Powell and that we can find the votes here to confirm him.
Can you imagine a world in which you'd vote against the Fed nominee if it's not Jay Powell?
Well, we'll see. I mean, you say there's only two choices.
That's what they're telling us.
Yeah, yeah. Life's about choices, right? So
that's right.
My hope is that it'll be Jay Powell.
My interview with Senator Rob Portman, Republican of Ohio.